Shafa'a comes from the Arabic word shafa'. And we know that wa-shafa'i wal-watr is the even and the odd. So shafa'a literally means something that is even. So when a person is by himself, he's single, he is odd. But when someone comes to help him, when someone comes to plead his case, he has a lawyer or someone, he has now a supporter. So he's not one anymore. He's not odd anymore. He's become double. He's become even. And that is what shafa'a comes from. The shafa'a is you have someone's help. We find verses in the Quran where outright it says, وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَ. And no shafa'a will be accepted from anyone. Other verses, يَوْمٌ لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ وَلَا خُلَّةٌ وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. That day, the day of judgment, when there will be no friendship, no trade, and no intercession, no shafa'ah. And so one group of people thought that there is actually no intercession. On the day of judgment, there is no one who can come and support you. That's it. But those people were actually wrong, because they only understood half of the story. Because other verses, for example, the verse I just recited, is the verse right before Ayat al-Kursi. And in Ayat al-Kursi itself, the verse right after, it says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ. And who can make shafa'ah, who can intercede in front of Allah, except by His permission. So we know the general rule is that there is no shafa'ah, no one can help you. But the exception is also mentioned, except if they have the permission from Allah. So what are these conditions? And how does it differ from the shafa'ah in the dunya? In the dunya, we know that shafa'ah is done when, for example, you're in a timeout, and you know your parents are really angry with you, and you're like, man, they don't even want to talk to me. So you call your brother, like, hey, or your sister, hey, can you please tell mom, like, I'll be nice next time. And you know, I told her it wasn't my fault. I didn't push the other kid. He fell by mistake. And so this person goes to the parent and he says, mommy, it wasn't his fault. This happened, that happened. He explains the whole story. And mommy listens to him and is like, yeah, okay, fine. You know, I think we can end the timeout now. But what does this imply? This implies that the parent actually didn't have full knowledge. They didn't know what actually happened. Right? So the intercession in the dunya, whether it's for job, whether it's in the government, it's you're talking to an authority saying that this person has skills that I can attest to, maybe you don't know about them. But that clearly does not apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows every single thing about us. He knows our sins that we ourselves would have forgotten. He knows things that we're thinking that others can't even know. So how can that apply to Allah when He already knows the full story? No one can tell Allah more of the story. Another thing is that when someone is in a position of authority, they can make shafa'ah. They can, like, you know, I'm the minister here. I'm the mayor of the city. So please do this and please do that. And people are forced to listen because a person in higher authority is asking them to do something. But is there anyone who has more authority than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Of course not. So that also does not apply in the hereafter. No one can force Allah to do anything. Even the angels or the prophets, even our dear Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we'll see later in the khutbah. Another thing is that shafa'ah, what it does, for example, if you're applying for a job, and there might be many applicants, one of them, for example, he doesn't have enough qualification, he doesn't have enough experience, but he's sort of there, but other candidates are more deserving of that position. But if he gets shafa'ah, if he gets a reference, if he gets a good word put in, what happens? They might hire him, right? Now, if you look at it, is that fair? Someone who he doesn't meet the qualifications fully, but he is given the job and the salary. Why? Because of a reference? Because of he had the shafa'ah? Is that fair? It's not fair to the other people who work so hard and they are better qualified and they can better contribute to the company and the project. It's not fair. So of course, how can Allah do something that's not fair? Again, that does not apply to Allah. Allah would only do something that is fair. Therefore, the shafa'ah, the intercession that we think of in the dunya, does not apply in the akhirah. And that is why Allah says that, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ
لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ وَلَا خُلَّةٌ وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَالْكَافِرُونَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ.
O you who believe, spend and given charity from what I have given to you before the day comes when there's going to be no friendship, no friends can help you. There's going to be no trade, you cannot do any transactions, and no shafa'ah, no intercession. No one can come and plead your case in front of Allah. And that is this concept of shafa'ah, is that Allah knows everything. So who can tell Allah more of the story? No one can. No one can force Allah against His will. So no one can say anything that if Allah doesn't want to listen, it's end game. And lastly, Allah is not unjust. If someone deserves to be punished, he deserves to be punished. If he didn't work all his life for the paradise, if he wasted his time, if he delved into sins and desires, then why should he get the same level as someone who prayed the night, who memorized the Quran, who read and he learned and he was nice to his parents? Why should they both get the same level just because someone's pleading their case? That's not fair. And that is why Allah says, there is no shafa'ah like that. Now let's come to the other side of the story. But there is shafa'ah, which was, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. So what is this exception to the rule? We know from ahadith that a shaheed, a martyr, will be able to intercede for 70 people. We know that a hafil of the Qur'an, and there's a slight weakness in this hadith, but it says that he will be able to intercede for 10 people. So how are they able to do that? And we know, for example, that you will be able to intercede for your family members. A teacher, a sheikh, an imam would be able to intercede for his followers. But how? What are the conditions? So first of all, let's imagine the Day of Judgment. The Day of Judgment is here. And all the angels and humans are standing in rows.
يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفَّا لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَقَالَ صَوَابًا.
That day, when even Jibreel alayhi salam and the other angels are standing in rows, and no one is allowed to speak, spin drop silence, except whom Allah gives permission. And they say the truth. Now if that's the environment, you're not allowed to speak, you're not allowed to plead anyone's case, then of course the first condition is going to be is that Allah has to give you permission. And Allah has to be happy with the person who is about to speak. And that is why scholars derive two or three conditions for this shafa'ah. What is the exception to the rule? And the first one we find in the Quran,
يَوْمَ لَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّفَاعَةُ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَرَضِيَ لَهُ قَوْلًا.
That day, the intercession, the shafa'ah, will not benefit except for whom Allah is happy with and He gives him permission. So whoever is trying to intercede, the intercessor himself, the supporter, Allah has to be happy with him first. And Allah has to give him permission first. Then he can start to speak. Otherwise, it's pin drop silence, no one is allowed to talk. So if, for example, there's a shaykh who claims that if you're my follower, then I will plead your case and I will pull you out of here off the hellfire, no matter how many sins you have. Then you know that he's lying. Because if Allah is not happy with him, if he's committing shirk, if he's committing bid'ah, if Allah is not going to be happy with him, he won't be even be able to talk on the Day of Judgment. Second condition.
وَلَا يَشْفَعُونَ إِلَّا لِمَنِ ارْتَضَى.
And they will not intercede except with whom Allah is happy. In another verse, which is even more emphatic.
وَكَمْ مِنْ مَلَكٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ لَا تُغْنِي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرْضَى.
And how many angels there are in the heavens whose intercession will be useless except after Allah gives them permission, and for whom Allah is happy. The most pious person you will find will have the least of sins. And we know that angels never commit sins. Angels are the closest to Allah, always busy in tasbih and tahreed of Allah. So even if their intercession is useless, then what about anyone else? So Allah is saying, and even the angels' intercession will be useless except for the person they're making, Allah is happy with that person. Meaning that that person now, so the first condition was, the person who is making intercession, Allah allows him to make the intercession, and he's happy with him. Second condition, for the person he's making the intercession, Allah is happy with that person. That, okay, this person has some khayr in it, so maybe, you know, you can intercede for him. So now, I'll give you a story from my personal life. Now, I'm not a really good developer, but I'm like medium. So I was applying to different companies, and one of my friends was working at Uber, which is, you know, one of the Silicon Valley companies, high-end. I was like, I don't know if I have a chance, but let me try, right? And when I tried, they wouldn't respond to me. So I told my friend, hey, can you put in a reference for me? So he gave them my reference, and lo and behold, I got a call from Uber. I'm really happy, I'm like, yay, you know, I'm getting an interview with them. My first interview passed, my second interview. In my second interview, they gave me some really crazy problem that I couldn't solve. And so they said, you know what, we're not going to hire you. Moral of the story, that is a very good example of how Shafa'ah worked. First of all, my friend had a good enough position and he was trustworthy in the company that they thought that, okay, his reference deserves enough time to be given an interview. Second condition is that they were happy with him and they accepted his referral, so they gave me that chance. Now the third condition, so the first condition was he was allowed to refer because they were hiring. Second condition is that they were happy with him, they trusted him. So they allowed him and they were happy with him. Third condition, when it came to me, I didn't meet the skill set. And so I was not hired. And that is how Shafa'ah works. Is that you have to have all the ingredients. The person who is making Shafa'ah, Allah has to give him permission. Allah has to be happy with him. And the person for whom they're making Shafa'ah, he has to deserve that paradise. He has to deserve that exit from hellfire. There's this concept of Shafa'ah al-Uzma. Shafa'at al-Uzma. The biggest Shafa'ah. And on the Day of Judgment, when all the human beings, from Adam until the last human being, they're all gathered in this one ground. And the sun is near their heads. And it's like the mountains are like wool, and they're like moving like foam, and things are crashing into each other, and there's horrors everywhere, and people are just standing and standing and standing, and they're waiting for Allah to start the accountability of people. And that day is going to be 50,000 years long. And so people will get tired, and from the horrors, they'll be shaking, and finally they'll have, we've had enough. Even the disbelievers would say, Ya Allah, just start the accountability. Just put us in the hellfire, but we can't wait anymore. We cannot go through these horrors anymore. Just end this, you know? So they would want to end this. And everyone would say, okay, who should we go to? Who is the most closest to Allah? And they would think that the human being that Allah made with his own hands, Adam alayhi salam, they would go to him. And they would say, Ya Adam, Allah created you with his own hands. You are our father. You are the father of all human beings. So why don't you go and plead to Allah, make shafa'ah to Allah, that Ya Allah, please start the accountability. End this day of horror. And Adam alayhi salam would say, Nafsi, nafsi, no, myself, myself. I'm afraid for myself. I'm afraid Allah is so angry today. And I remember I ate from the tree when I was supposed to not eat from the tree. I cannot go to Allah and talk to Him. I'm too afraid for myself. Nafsi, nafsi, you go. You go and talk to Nuh alayhi salam. He was the first messenger sent to mankind. So people will go to Nuh alayhi salam. And Nuh alayhi salam would say the same thing. Oh no, nafsi, nafsi, I'm afraid for myself. I made a dua I should not have made. Allah told me to not make dua for the people who are drowning. But my son was drowning and I started making dua. I'm afraid Allah will hold me accountable. I'm not gonna talk to Allah today. I'm too afraid. Nafsi, nafsi, go and talk to Ibrahim alayhi salam, who is Khalilur Rahman, who is the close friend of Allah. Maybe he could do something. They would go to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam would say, you know, today I'm too afraid. I actually lied 3 times in my life. Nafsi, nafsi. I lied when I said that I'm sick, so people would leave me with the idols and go to the festival. I lied when I said that the bigger of the idols kill the smaller idols. And I lied that Sarah is my sister, even though she's only my sister in Islam. So even though they're technically not lies, they're like hilas, but he's so afraid that he's saying, nafsi, nafsi, I'm not going to talk to Allah. Why don't you go talk to Musa, Kalimullah? He has already spoke to Allah before. Maybe today he can also speak. So they would go to Musa alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam would say, no, no, nafsi, nafsi, I'm too afraid. Remember, I had killed a Coptic when we got into the fight. I'm afraid, even though he did that by mistake. He's too afraid to talk to Allah. He's like, no, no, I'm too afraid. Go to Isa alayhi salam, Ruhullah. Allah created him without a father. And so they would go to Isa alayhi salam, and Isa alayhi salam would say the same thing. Nafsi, nafsi, I'm too afraid for myself. Why don't you go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And everyone would gather and they would come and plead and talk to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Rasulullah, can you please talk to Allah? You know, end this day of horror. And what would Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Ana laha, yes, I'm for this. Yes, this is my job. And he would go, and he says that he would start making praises of Allah in front of his throne. Praises that Allah would inspire him that he had not known before. And after that, he would keep praising and praising and praising Allah, and he would go into sajda. And he would put his head down in the sajda, and he's continuing the praises until Allah would say, Ya Muhammad, irfa' ra'sak. Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, raise your head. Ask, you shall be given. Intercede, your intercession shall be accepted. And what would Prophet ﷺ say? He can ask for anything now. Rasulullah ﷺ would say, Ummati, Ummati, my Ummah, my Ummah. Right? And he would intercede for the believers. He would intercede for people who had Iman. And so with his intercession, the accountability would start. And the hadith mentions a very key word. And that word is, فَيَحُدُّ لِي حَدًّا. When Allah asks me to make intercession, He will make a boundary for me. He will specify the group that I can make intercession for. So even Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cannot make intercession for anyone. Remember his own uncle, Abu Talib, when he dies, without saying La ilaha illallah, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not able to save him. So the actual control is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he asked the Messenger of Allah, he said, Ya Rasulullah, who will be the most deserving of your shafa'ah on the Day of Judgment? And look at the response. The Rasulullah said, Man qala la ilaha illallah khalisan min qalbih. Whoever says la ilaha illallah, there is no God, there is no one worthy of worship except Allah, sincerely from his heart. The more sincere he is, the more deserving he will be of my shafa'ah on the Day of Judgment. What that shows us is that it's our own actions, it's our own perfection of tawheed, it's how good our relationship is with Allah, that is what will determine whether we get the shafa'ah or not. Not how close we are to our shaykh, not how close we are to the angels, not how close we are to the prophets. No, it's all about how close we are to Allah.